This is Ham Radio Now, episode 209. Goodbye, Bill. Bill Pasternack, WA6ITF, Silent Key. Last week, probably most of you know, hopefully this isn't coming as news to anybody who's watching the program, but it is, it's possible that it is. And normally this is the part of the program where I point back at Arvin and say, contribute to Ham Radio Now. We got something else that if you're generous enough, you want to help out with from this program. We'll tell you about it in a little bit. It's the Young Ham of the Year Award that is in search of some funding. So we'll talk about that in a little bit. This is a Goodbye Bill program, and I have managed to put together a pretty substantial group of people at a very, very much the last minute. I'm going to try something dangerous. I'm going to promote you all to full screen and see what happens. I have live picture from three of our guests and a still picture from one and no picture at all from the other. But in no particular order, down here in this corner is Rich Moseson, W2VU. Rich is editor of CQ Magazine. Skeeter Nash, whose name is...
What's my real name?
Whose real name is showing up here, but we'll continue to call you Skeeter.
Okay.
N5ASH. Jim Davis is the frozen picture over here, W2JKD.
I think there's a song that goes along with that, Frozen, isn't there?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I thought so.
You're not licensed to play, though, so.
Oh, that's right.
I've lost control of the program already.
That didn't take long.
Don
never put a bunch of old announcers together.
Yeah, exactly.
Don Wilbanks is down here in this corner.
Where and, I should be.
And to round out the Ham Nation end of things is Amanda Alden, who is K1DDN.
So, hey, guys.
Thank you all for coming by. You're all here in various forms of association with Bill Pasternack. Some of you have known him for a long, long time. Some of you have known him for only a short time, but he has been a mentor or Elmer to you in various ways. And we're going to find out a little bit about that. Before we start, like I said, I think just about everybody knows that Bill passed away last week. You probably also know that he was in the hospital starting around Thanksgiving last year, and then back out for a little while, first of this year, and then back in. And the things that were wrong with him finally took his life last week. I don't know if we can go into very much more detail. Skeeter, you probably know more than anybody else. What kind of detail we ought to or ought not to go into. He's been in fairly poor health for a year or so.
True.
I'm not sure there's much more that we want or can say about that. Bill's a public figure, but his private life is private.
Yeah. He only wanted put out basically what he felt needed to be put out as far as his health was concerned over the last several months. So suffice it to say, the man was 72 years old. He was a diabetic. I mean, that's not an uncommon situation when you get to be in those advanced years. And so there were just a whole lot of other contributing factors that led to his declining health. But his spirit never really declined, I can tell you that. And anybody that talked to him over the last few months can testify to that, that's for sure. He was so concerned about Newsline continuing, and all we kept saying to him was, Bill, your health comes first, so you need to focus on that, and you know, Newsline will eventually get handled. And so that's kind of the way it was left at this point anyway. But when he got out of the hospital the first time, or before he got out of the hospital the first time, actually, when he was well enough to begin writing scripts again, that was when he asked for help. And I kind of waited. I kind of held back because I really didn't have a lot of time to devote to it. But when I didn't see after about a day and a half any response on coming on board, somebody coming on board and at least editing a show together, I got a hold of him and I said, okay, you know, I'll do it for as long as I can. And so that was how we relaunched Newsline. I believe it was with 1965 or 66, the episode number. So that was when we got it back up and running earlier this year.
And so Newsline is suspended again for now.
For now, because obviously we've lost our head writer, our executive producer at this point. Now, I put out a call a while back when Bill was in ICU. this last time, just before he took this last turn for the worse. And I thought we needed to probably see who might be out there, because I knew I didn't have the time to write a script. And I'm not a news writer. I mean, I could write. I probably could write one just because of my radio background. And I have worked filling in as a news director back in the past years. But, you know, it's kind of a specialty to write a newscast like that. And so I kind of was looking for anybody that was that had an amateur radio background and a writing background and understood broadcasting and a news format, which is basically the way that we presented it. And the response I got was, hey, I'll help anchor, I'll help do reports, and that's all well and good, and it won't hurt to add to that aspect of Newsline as we go down the road. But really, I was looking for a writer-producer to take Bill's place that had the time to do it. And I think we may have found somebody, and we will actually talk more about that once we're back into a position where we're going to start assembling another newscast to get us back online.
Do you think we're talking weeks, months, or total unknown?
I don't know. Don and I really haven't had a chance to talk a whole lot directly to each other about it, because it's kind of been our...
there you go.
It's kind of been our responsibility, more or less, to get it back up and going, I think. Yeah. I mean, Don's done such a great job with the video segments that he puts on Ham Nation that are kind of culled from each week's newscast. But I did share with him a contact that was made with me from a ham who has a news writing background, has a general class license, and is quite eager to come on board and help us get a script together. So that may be happening maybe in the next couple of weeks. We're gonna see what the first draft of the script looks like and see if we can proceed from there.
Yeah, we were actually talking with her via email earlier today, and in fact, for the last week or so. And it is a lady. We're not going to announce her name or her call yet, because nothing is set in stone yet. But she's very enthusiastic, and she's very well qualified, and it's something that she wants to do. And I think that actually she'll be a perfect fit. In fact, Skeeter, I think. I saw in an email earlier that when you were reading her biography or her qualifications to Bill, what was Bill's response?
Bill said, hire her.
Yeah. So we're going to do
that. That was in the last conversation that you and I had with him. We had a conference call.
That's
it was
right.
A week ago yesterday, Sunday.
That's right. It was.
Yeah. Last time I talked
right.
to him.
Right. The three of us was the
and
last.
And did he tell time. You to pay her double the salary that he was paying you?
Yeah, of course. Of
sure,
course.
Absolutely.
Okay, that's the disembodied voice of Rich Moseson, W2VU, our CQ editor. If people watching, you can see a little bit of flashing around the corners of the windows here. You can tell who's talking, well, at least when I have that shot up. So you can tell what's going on. In fact, I got a complaint from the last program that I did. Somebody said that it's really distracting. I can't turn it off. Nothing we
only,
can do.
Only one?
Only one. Well, you know, that counts for hundreds and hundreds.
And how much did they contribute to, you know, Arvin the Pig?
When somebody writes a comment, I don't go looking for that sort of thing.
Okay.
I don't care.
It's like, you know, if you're not paying for it, then don't complain.
Well, yeah. It's probably mostly because I'm lazy, not because I don't want to know, but I don't go digging up. So Newsline could be coming back. And if that doesn't pan out for some reason, you're going to keep on looking. We're kind of dedicated to looking for it. I have a plan A, and I don't know how long plan A is going to hold together here for this program, but we'll see. The next thing in plan A is for us to talk about Bill and how we knew him, and you know what he meant, and what our association with him was, in a personal or professional, whatever you guys want to come up with. And Jim Davis. W2JKD, you're one of the anchors for Newsline, and I think you go back pretty close to the beginning. Am I right?
Well, yeah, yes, before the beginning, actually, Gary, and I think Rich Moseson probably knows Bill longer than I do, but the early days of 2 meter FM, I had bought myself a Hammerland FM 50A out of a bakery truck in Detroit for $50. It had the potential to get onto 2 meter FM, which was the up and rising format. So I stuck it in the back of my car, and for 2 years I kept it on, and it never made a sound. And then I moved. My career took me to New York City to a radio station where I was a DJ at WOR FM, and I came across a fellow who said, "Well, you know, repeaters are coming alive here, and there's a 1376 machine in Manhattan known as the Sewer WA2SUR. George Ledoux K1TKJ was the helm of that, and there's another silent key that we dearly miss." And the machine was known as the party machine. We were all young kids. I was 25 years old at the time. And we partied hard. And this repeater group got together at people's houses. And it was there that I met Bill Pasternack. Of course, it was with his two call rather than his six call. And so that goes back basically 45 years ago.
What was he doing back then?
Our ways...
When I talked to him in New York,
Rich probably would have a better.
Okay.
Rich might have a better handle on that than I would. I don't really know at that point. Yeah, we were
actually
young kids,
actually Jim, you've known Bill longer. I've only known him about 35 years, and he was already in California at that time.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Rich. Well, yeah, somewhere along the way, I think those of us in the broadcasting business, our careers travel across the country, and by coincidence alone, around 1976-77, I arrived in Los Angeles and looked up my old friend Bill Pasternack. And Bill said, "Have you got a little time?" And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "I want to come over to your house. I want to play something for you." He arrived on my doorstep with a little Grundig beat-up tape recorder, a little cassette player. And he pressed the button, and there was he and Bill and Jim Hendershot with the first edition that I'd ever heard of the Westlink Amateur Radio News. And it was compelling. It was terrific. I thought, what a great addition to our hobby. And time went by, and I became an anchor, I think around 1978, somewhere around in there. I think this is my 37th or 38th year of anchoring a Newsline. I was a kid, like I say. I was 28.
Yeah, it had...
I started doing Newsline, and I'm going to be 70 years old in November, so that puts it in perspective. But yeah. Anyway, somewhere along the way, I moved to West Virginia. I managed my first radio station in 1980, and Bill said to me, "I'd still like to do this remotely with you. Can we do Newsline?" I think by that time, I'm sure it was still Westlink. But anyway, here's how we did it, and this is the amazing part. This kind of shows the dedication of Bill Pasternack. He would call me up, and he would read me the newscast that he had written over the telephone. I would laboriously type it on a typewriter with my Hunt and Peck typing. And,
wow.
And then I would go into a studio. I'd grab a 7-inch reel of tape, running at 7.5 inches a second. And I would record that Westlink radio news. And I would slice it and dice it with the razor blade and the splicing tape. And then I would rush to the post office and throw it in an airmail bag to get it to Los Angeles. And then Bill would do a little further embellishment on it. And then it would go into a broadcast cartridge machine that had a 30-minute cartridge in it. And repeater operators would dial up the dial-up number and play it over the auto patch. And that's how we got Newsline on the air. I say this because I think it's really important to know the kind of dedication that Bill had to this. Somewhere along the way, I think the VIC-20 came along. That was a great godsend because when we got the VIC-20, all of a sudden we could now transfer files back and forth by a modem, a very slow modem, I might mention, but at least my daisy wheel printer would print the Newsline. And we were still doing the same thing, airmail bags back and forth. But over the years, and a lot of years have passed quickly, I think we all know that in life speeds up as we go along. And boy, it's zipping along right now for me. But I will say this, the dedication that Bill Pasternack had to this hobby is insurmountable, to the point where Bill would call me up about once a month and say, "Jim, I'm stuck for an anchor this week. Could you do it?" Sometimes it was inconvenient to do that, I must tell you. But I looked at myself and I said, this man has worked so hard to put together this incredible program. How could I possibly say no? And so I would just write back one word on an email and say, sure. And the next thing I knew, I was in the studio. Things changed a lot over the years. Technology was beneficial to us. And the next thing you know, we were posting it on the internet and drawing it down from an FTP file. A wonderful way that things have, the technology has improved. I just want to say a couple of things. Bill brought us so many things, but he is so underappreciated in my mind. He brought us the Young Ham of the Year. In my mind, Bill Pasternack is the amateur radio operator of a lifetime. He deserves the Lifetime Achievement Award. I know of no one more dedicated in my life to our wonderful hobby, to the promulgation of ham radio, than Bill Pasternack, WA6ITF. I know that his the obit said he was 73. Skeeter, I think you mentioned he was 72. I think 73. Let's call him 73 because yeah. It's perfect appropriate year for our hobby. Bill perfect. Pasternack, 73s, buddy. 73 is from your buddies
yeah.
here.
Yeah, 73 is it's a little early on the life scale, but it's a good long life at that point. And I think he enjoyed his. I have an interview that I did earlier today with Jim Hendershot, and I'm going to put that in here in just a minute. But I want to go to the other end of Bill's timeline and talk to Amanda for a second, because Amanda, you are probably the newest ham in Bill's circle that's on the show here. So tell me a little bit about what your experience was with Bill and what he did for you.
Well, first, I didn't know who Bill was, and we didn't regularly listen to amateur radio newsline. So I was a new ham in 2009, and I got on Ham Nation, I think, in 2011, 12, whenever it was the debut was. And he took one of my stories. I was talking about doing the Waldo Canyon fire here for MCOM. And that's when I first became aware of him. And I said, hey, if you need to know any more about what's going on, let me know. I'll give you some more information. And he said, okay, I'd like to help you too. He thought I could use some help with my presence on Ham Nation and everything in general. So he pulled me under his wing and gave me a lot of helpful hints, and then started sharing all kinds of nice stories about his old broadcasting days. That was really amazing. He was going back to explaining how RCA ribbon microphones worked. Just all the great stories I couldn't imagine. And then we talked about some of the Young Ham of the Years, and we found out we had a great friend in common, Brian Milishowski. And N5ZGT, if anyone doesn't know who he is, he's the Rocky Mountain Division director. Anyhow, and we both have a love for Albuquerque, and we talked about the Hot Air Balloon Festival there. Just so many different common interests, but so far away from each other and where we grew up or anything else, but always, he was just a friend. He would just send me emails occasionally, say, hey, how are things going? And I would do the same for him, finding out how he was feeling. And then I started sending him the chat from Ham Nation. So the days that he wasn't there to join us for the show, he could still catch up on what everyone was saying and wishing him well when he was not joining us.
So Bill
really
was,
miss him.
Yeah, Bill was basically a broadcast mentor, a coach.
Yeah,
teaching how to do this television thing.
Yeah, and actually he helped me write a few things too. I was doing some PIO stuff for ham radio around here, and I would send him, what do you think? Did I write this okay? Is this good for press? And no. No, why don't you try this? Take out this, reword this. I mean, he did it, and I knew he didn't really have time, but he wanted to see it. He loved doing it, and it's always been so helpful.
Yeah, I like that. Is this good enough? No, no. He did not mince words or try to soothe your feelings. He just went right for it.
Right.
So
right.
Cool.
But it was helpful.
It seems to have worked, because I think you're very popular on Ham Nation.
Well, thank you. I really enjoy the show. I think I get really nervous. I don't come from this background at all. You know, I work in a print shop. So learning to present yourself and speak well and coming up with the right words, I still am not there. I wish I had a background in journalism where I was a little bit more cultured and educated, but I do the best that I can. And having people like Bill in your life really make it a lot easier.
Yeah, I can't tell you how many times I'm in the middle of a sentence and I'm heading for a payoff word, and my brain is telling me, You don't know what that word is yet. You better hope you get to it by the end of the sentence. You know, that yeah. is going on in parallel with I'm still talking.
Yeah.
And sometimes I can hear Don in there. I get there, the word has not yet arrived. Mm-hmm. So I'm panicking for a replacement. So I feel so much like I'm back on Ham Nation here. I guess we'll go with our next Ham Nation anchor. And Don, I remember early on, I suggested to Bob Heil that a Newsline segment would be good. I don't know if that's the reason why it got on or not. He may have already been working on that. But within a few shows, it wasn't you at first. No. There was another anchor.
Right.
He tried for a little while and then had health problems. And has he passed away?
He's still. To my knowledge, he is not. And I'm, like you, searching for that payoff word at the end of the phrase. I'm horrible with names. And I can see him and I can
Bob
hear him.
Bob Sudock.
Bob Robert Sudock.
Yeah.
WB6FDF.
And exactly. He was alive as of about a couple of months ago because Bill and I shared a Skype call. With yeah. him.
Okay.
I was calling Bill after a long night of editing Newsline. It was like midnight on a Friday night, and I missed the deadline, and I was, you know, I'd put in probably about a 10-hour day at work and came home and was slaving over a hot iMac when I called Bill to let him know, okay, it's done, it's uploaded. And he said, well, say hello to Bob Sudock. And says, well, hello, Bob. Very nice to meet yeah. you. Because I remember him from those early Ham Nation features featuring Newsline. So, yeah. He, as far as I know, he's still around.
Okay, way it started was the idea, at least from my knowledge, is I had heard, Bill actually had told me that Newsline was going to have a presence on Ham Nation. It was going to be Robert Sudock. I'm like, well, that's cool. That's awesome. And then like, okay, it was supposed to be whatever week it was. Week 13 or something like that. Maybe even earlier than that. And it came and went, and Ham Nation, our Newsline wasn't on there. And then again, it came and went. And then again, it came and went. And so I emailed, and I said, what's the deal? I thought we were supposed to be on there. And he said, well, Bob has got some health issues. And I said, well, if, you know, I don't know how to do any of this, but if you need somebody to, you know, to fill in until Bob gets back, I'm more than happy to do that. And so the first amateur radio Newsline, I guess, headlines on Ham Nation was me. And then Sudock was able to do it again. And I watched with great joy as Bob presented that. And I watched his great, mine was just a talking head. Like you're seeing now, and Bob had the whole video behind him and the up in the corner the images and everything. I'm like, man, I want to do that. I want to learn how to do that. And then he fell ill again, and then it came to me, I guess, more or less on a permanent basis. And it's been learn as you go for the last several years that we've done that. But Bill Pasternack is irreplaceable. We did a memorial package for him. And I got up early Saturday morning, after he had passed away. I guess it was Friday morning because he passed away Thursday night. I got up early Friday morning and I was going to start on this memorial package. And I got up and I started looking at pictures, and then I started trying to write, and I knew there was no way I could do it. And so Mark Abramovich, NT3V, who is the, a professional newsman at KYW in Philadelphia, another name, Mark Abrams. I was communicating with him, and he said, well, I'm more than happy to write it if you want me to. And I said, man, that'd be a great help. So he wrote it, and I read it, and I emailed him back, and I said, there's no way in hell I'm going to be able to get through this. Would you? And I think that Mark Abramovich is the ultimate, consummate professional newsman when it comes to something like this. He's able to separate himself from the gravity of the situation. That I'm not a newsman. I'm just a goofy morning disc jockey and production guy. He sent me back a piece of audio, and I didn't change a thing. I did an intro and a closeout on it, and basically I went to Bill's Facebook page and pulled about 100 pictures and rotated those underneath it, and that's out there now. And just thanks to Mark, because there's no way that the man meant so much to me. He was like an older brother. He's like an uncle. He was definitely a mentor, a great friend, and oh man, we had some fun together. Some of my fondest memories I'll take to the grave are picking him up in Birmingham, Alabama, after he'd flown to David Black's house from Los Angeles, and then riding with me the rest of the way up to Huntsville. And there was a time or two we shared a hotel room, but just a great guy and so giving of himself. He's kind of like Bob Heil, in that Bob Heil doesn't have no in his vocabulary. Well, neither did Bill. And Jim, like you, there were times when he would call me up and say, "Hey, can you anchor?" And you know, and it didn't matter what I was doing, and the answer was always yes, until it couldn't be, until there was just absolutely no way. And I told Dawn, my wife, I said, "I had to tell Bill no today, and I don't know how to do that." I remember one night, you know, Newsline went for 37 years without missing a week. That's an amazing stretch. And the only reason it missed a week was because our leader was down. That's the only reason why it missed, and that wasn't through any fault of anybody else. We tried the best we could, and it just, things happened. But I remember one night there was, Dawn and I had gone out somewhere, and it was a Friday night, it was a Thursday night, because we always released on Friday. It was a Thursday night at 11 o'clock. I had gone to bed, and I had just rolled over to kiss her goodnight, and it popped into my head, "Oh my God, I've got a Newsline script to do." I told her, I said, "I've got to get up. I've got to go do Newsline." She said, "Are you freaking kidding me?" I said, "No. We've never missed a deadline at 11:30 at night." And now here's the thing. Bill sends a script. I have to proofread this script because Bill writes like he spoke.
Yeah.
And so I would have to go in and proofread and check the call signs to make sure they were all okay. And in some cases go on and, wow, how do I pronounce this word? He gave me the hard words because I'm usually pretty good at pronunciation. So a 30-minute script took me 30 minutes to read and proofread, and then I would have to go in and read it for good into the microphone with all the edits and everything, go back and edit it down later and process it. And so what takes 30 minutes that you hear is an hour and a half process. So by 1 o'clock, 1:30 in the morning, I'm finally going back to bed. And she's like, "Don't you ever do that again." I said, "Well, we've never missed a deadline. We can't. We can't miss a deadline." And so, but Bill had that effect on people. You could not say no to him. And if you had to say no, it was like you were kicking a puppy, because you couldn't, as much as that man did, you couldn't let him down. Just couldn't.
That is the idea of never missing a deadline in 37 years. And you know that there were some squeakers besides getting you up at midnight to finish off.
There had been delays, you know, to where, okay, we've never missed, okay, yeah, maybe we have to release it on Saturday or Sunday or Monday or something because of breaking news coming in, but we never missed a week. That was the thing. For 37 years we never missed a week until he was incapacitated and there wasn't a script. I think he went into the hospital like on a Wednesday or something, and of course, you know, I normally got the script on Wednesday or Thursday to record, and so there was just no way to get one done, and we had to miss. And it's like I told him, I said, "Dude, 37 years, take a weekend off, for crying out loud." Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, take a vacation.
Yeah, I think that there was something about, and this happens all across ham radio, somebody gets an idea of something that they want to do. Now, Bill built up a huge crew of people to help, but I think he had too much on his shoulders all by himself for a long time.
Yeah, he did. He absolutely did. That was one of the things that is so frustrating now, in that Bill, for all of, you know, he lived his life around technology. He was a broadcast engineer. There probably isn't a piece of videotape gear that he hadn't worked on and fixed and knew how to fix, but yet the man still carried around a flip phone. And Jim, you know, he probably still has that machine that he brought over to your house, 37, 38, 38. It's probably still in his house. I got an email that there are literally boxes of hundreds and hundreds of cassette tapes of old Newsline recordings.
Still in his. Fact, actually, I think he's got some of the old reel-to-reels that go back.
Yeah,
to the
I'm
70s,
sure he does.
80s. Yeah.
I FedExed a bunch of them to him. You know, back in, you know, I've been doing it for 20 years, and I FedExed a bunch of them to him. But yeah, it just. But he was just. He didn't. he didn't think ahead enough, and this is probably his only fault. He kind of subscribed to the if you want it done right, do it yourself kind of a thing. Yeah. I think, and he didn't think ahead enough to have any type of contingency plan for this. It's something that we had talked about in board meetings for a couple of years, but you know, one of those things where you get too busy and you put it on the back burner, and eventually the flame goes out on the stove, and you just can't. You know, I mean, you run out of time, and that's kind of where we were with this. So it's been a struggle to get back up and running, but we will get it back up and running. Skeeter and I will get it back up and running. It's going to be in a slightly different format, a little shorter. We're going to go to, I think we had talked about two segments instead of three, so keep it to under 20 minutes, about 18 minutes probably, and make a few more changes to kind of modernize it a little bit, because Bill, for all his talent at writing, he wrote the same way forever and ever and ever. And so we're going to try to modernize it a little bit and bring it into the 21st. And this is no slight against Bill at all. I don't want anyone to think that I'm criticizing the man, because I loved him. Absolutely loved him. But we're going to try to improve on what he started. And the Young Ham of the Year Award will be presented this year at Huntsville.
All right.
So I can tell you that.
Skeeter, we'll get to you in just a moment, but I want to make a really awkward segue, because, you know, that's what I'm kind of known for here on Ham Radio Now, besides programs that run forever, and I couldn't make a 20-minute show if my life depended on it. So speaking of missing deadlines, Rich Moseson, W2VU, CQ's back on schedule now, I think.
You're right. It was an awkward segue. yes, thankfully we are, but we're here to talk about Bill tonight.
Yeah. So tell me a little bit of your history.
I've known Bill for probably a little more than 30 years, thinking about it now. When I first met him, I was working at CBS News as a producer. But it was Bill who gave me my first opportunity to be a field producer. And for those of you who are not in the world of television, that's the person who goes out in the field with the camera crew to shoot a story. The program that I had been working on at the time was done entirely in studio with library footage, so we never shot any of our own footage. And Bill was working on one of his many videos for the ARRL at the time. And this is, you know, for those of you who know Bill only as the producer of Newsline, he had a whole bunch of other stuff that he was involved in quite heavily. And one of them was that for many, many years, he was the premier producer of amateur radio promotional videos for the ARRL. And he had me go to Washington. And for the first video segment that I ever field produced was with Senator John Glenn, following him from his office over to W3USS, the ham station in the Senate. Senator Glenn was never a ham, but always a very, very good friend of ham radio. His chief of staff was a ham, and he was a very, very strong supporter. And we went with him over to the ham station in one of the Senate office buildings and recorded him taking part in a CUSO with someone. And it was my first opportunity to be a field producer, which within a couple of years came in very, very handy as my responsibilities at CBS changed and I had to do field producing as well. And you may have just heard a greeting from my cat here. Hello. She just came by to visit.
Yeah, I've got one sitting. You can't quite see that. Yeah, there's one behind me trying to figure out how to get down.
And, you know, he did that for a lot of people. He did things like that for a lot of people. It's fascinating. Bill was never trained as a broadcast journalist or as a producer. He was as Don was just pointing out, he was a broadcast engineer. He was a technician. He was a technical person. He knew how everything worked and how to fix it. But he was never, in his professional life, in a position to either be in front of the camera or a producer who is behind the camera, but creating the material that actually goes on the air. And Ham Radio gave him the opportunity to do that. And that is one of the many little known wonderful things about our hobby, is that it gives people an opportunity, if they want it, to reach beyond wherever they may happen to be in their professional lives and to take on a completely different role and to become a leader in that role if they are so inclined and have the talent and ability to do that. And I remember working with Bill for quite a long time on writing. That was, as Don pointed out, not really his strongest suit.
He paid that forward to Amanda.
Yes, absolutely. because we worked quite a bit on that, and he learned very well. But the other thing that Bill was totally immersed in, and that I'm so glad that we've become involved with, was the Young Ham of the Year Award program. And, you know, as I'm honored to be on the selection committee for the award, and have been for at least 15 years now. And when I see these candidates that come across our desks, I have no concerns about the future of our hobby. Because we have wonderful people out there, young people, who are doing great things. And the Young Ham of the Year Award program provides an opportunity to showcase that and to recognize that. And he was so dedicated to that. If it was possible to be more dedicated to something than he was to Newsline, it was to the Young Ham of the Year Award program. And it has really been an honor to serve on that committee. And, you know, that's in its 27th year now. So basically all the people who are complaining now about how ham radio has no future were the exact people who were coming into the hobby at the time that this award was started. And everyone was saying that ham radio had no future.
Wow.
And they are.
Yeah, that's a heavy thought.
So I have confidence in our future as long as we have young people of the caliber that we see in the Young Ham of the Year Award process every year. And there are even more out there who don't get nominated, and we got to do a better job of getting the word out to have them be nominated so that we can offer recognition. But
have nominations closed for this year? Is it in the decision making?
It depends on what you were reading. It went out in two different places, in different places, in different forms. One said May 30th, and the other said June 30th. So the committee has decided to hold the nominating period open until June 30th.
Okay.
So if anyone is out there and you know a young ham who is doing remarkable stuff, and this is not, you know, just, oh, well, my 10-year-old got his extra.
Yep.
That's great.
Hold on just a second, Rich. Jim, I think your wife is doing the dishes behind you.
Oh, yes, she is.
I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to not do that, because
I'm going to mute.
Okay, muting will work. Water is an excellent noise blanker. Just covers everything up. Go ahead, Rich.
Okay. We decided to hold the nominating period open until June 30th because it was publicized in some places as being June 30th, even though it's normally the end of May, and in some places it said the end of May. So you've got a couple more weeks here. If you know of a young ham, 18 or under, who is doing remarkable stuff with ham radio, please go to the Amateur Radio Newsline Young Ham of the Year website and get the nominating forms and get them in. Although I'm not sure at the moment who's going to be reading that mailbox, because Bill is the administrator of the program. He never cast a vote on the committee, but he would collect the nominations and pass them along to the committee members. Hopefully somebody else is going to be reading that inbox and passing along any nominations that we get.
I'm in contact with the people in California who are managing his affairs, and I'll make sure that gets done.
Great, Don. Thank you.
Okay.
It was the Young Ham of the Year award that got me, that introduced me to Bill. This is kind of a cool story. In 1975, I was studying for my ham ticket as a 15-year-old. And then all of a sudden, girls and cars got to be more important than, you know, code and theory. So I put it down for 20 years. And in 94, my wife's uncle was a ham, and he had this funny-looking little handheld radio. And I said, what is that? He said, well, it's ham radio. And I said, man, I was studying that 20 years ago. He said, well, you ought to get your ticket. So I did. So I went out and I bought myself a Radio Shack HTX 202, and I started listening to the repeater. And there was this program that came on Monday night on the net called Amateur Radio Newsline. And being a broadcaster, I thought, this is just cool as it can be. So I was hooked. Got to be a big fan of Amateur Radio Newsline while I was listening to that. Got my ticket in January of 95. And in 93, we had a winner from New Orleans, Kevin Boudreau, N5XMH, who lived in New Orleans at the time. His story was he was doing, as a 16-year-old, I believe it was, he was at a shelter for a hurricane. I want to say it was Andrew or Gilbert that came through New Orleans. One of those two, I think, in 93. I remember I was in a radio station on the 10th floor watching the windows suck in and out. That night, Kevin was in a Red Cross shelter, and he was basically the only person there who had any authority, and the roof blew off. Well, Kevin, through his 2-meter handheld, made sure that the word got out and that help came, and no one was hurt. And his actions of taking control of that situation got him to be the 1993 Young Ham of the Year Award. So I'm driving around one day after work, after my morning show, and Kevin calls me on the repeater. He says, hey, do you have any plans on going to Huntsville? This is like in July or June. Do you have any plans on going to Huntsville in August? I said, no, I hadn't thought about it. Why? He said, well, the Young Ham of the Year Award is, and I want to go. I'm looking for a way to go. So if you want to split the gas and split a hotel room, I'd be more than happy to do that. And I said, you know what? Yeah, let's do that. And so he introduced me to Bill Pasternack. And Bill's like, yeah, you need to be part of Newsline. And so months after I became a ham, I'm thrust into this whole Newsline thing, and last year was the first year that I was not able to go to Huntsville. And oddly enough, last year there was no Young Ham of the Year winner awarded. So I've met every one of them for the last 20 years. And you're right, Rich. If these are the kind of kids that are in charge of the future of ham radio, we got nothing to worry about.
Yeah, I've had the chance.
And the thing is, they do go on to do wonderful things.
Right.
A couple of years back when we had the 25th year, we made a point of, well, Bill made a point of contacting as many of the past winners as he could. And they have all gone on to having really great careers, not necessarily related to ham radio, but they are leaders in whatever careers that they happen to be involved in. And I just this weekend, I was at HamCom in Dallas. And I ran into one of our former winners down there, Andrew Koenig from Houston.
I love Andrew.
And he was, when he was 15 years old, he was training astronauts on how to be hams.
Yep.
This is the caliber
That's cool.
of young people wow. that we get in this program. And, you know, he's now a student at University of Texas in Dallas, and very active in the radio club there, and I'm sure that there's going to be we're going to be seeing and hearing a lot more of him. Andrea Wayward, another incredible person who was young, started out yep. in becoming a leader as Young Ham of the Year. The kids that are recognized by this program are just incredible. And a lot of times, even those who don't win, you know, sometimes it's such a hard choice because we've got really great kids, and several of them nominated in 1 year, and we can only pick one. We've made a point here and there of letting people who didn't quite make it to the top position know that they're still very much appreciated, and the recognition is still there, even though they didn't happen to win the award that year, because they're just doing fantastic stuff. And more recently, Erin King, who is now at MIT, with she took her MIT acceptance tube that the letters come in and turned it into a payload for a near space satellite, balloon launch.
Yeah, she spent her first summer after MIT working on the Google Loon project.
Yeah.
I mean, again, this is the caliber of young people we have in our hobby today, and it's been through Bill's unending efforts that they have been recognized and spotlighted for over a quarter century.
And you know, it's not just the technical things that they're doing, like the last two, like Patrick Lissandre, who is a very technical kid, and like Erin King, and it's not just public service like Kevin Boudreau, but we had a winner, Toby Metz. I want to say is his name. What got him was he was. I think he did a bunch of ISS contacts, and he was actually teaching deaf people about ham radio through Packet and various other things. So there was, and he got a bunch of deaf people licensed. And one of the people that he got licensed was so enamored with the whole ham radio thing, even though he's deaf, he actually put a 2-meter mobile in his car, and he would drive around, he would watch the S meter, and he would see activity on it. And when that S meter would fall down and go to nothing and notice that there wasn't any activity, this man who was deaf, couldn't hear anything, would pick up that microphone and utter his call sign into the microphone to let people know that he was there.
Aww.
That wow. That is inspiring to me.
Yeah.
And the influence of this award program goes beyond the kids themselves sometimes. You were mentioning Mark Abramovitz before as an essential part of the Newsline team. Mark got involved with Newsline through the Young Ham of the Year Award because his son, I'm thinking Josh.
Josh.
I could be wrong. Josh.
I think you're right, yeah.
Was our winner about 10 years ago, maybe a little more at this point. But and he's gone on to do fantastic things too. But the whole experience got Mark pulled into the circle of the whole Newsline culture. And he has become a major part of not only Newsline, but he's been for the past, starting in the year after his son won the award, he's been on the award committee, and he's been chairman of the committee for at least the last 10 years. So
he actually replaced Larry Zetwalk, who in the very same way, Larry Zetwalk was an airline captain. His daughter won the Young Ham of the Year award.
Right, Allison.
Allison. And Bill asked Captain Zetwalk to take over the judging committee as the chairman. And then when Larry wanted to step down, Bill asked Mark, and Mark's like, how could I say no?
Okay, guys, hold on just a second. We're going to lose Amanda in a couple of minutes because she's got an Aries net to run. So that's very cool. But before you guys go, Don and Amanda, I wanted to congratulate you guys on episode 200 over at Ham Nation.
Well, thank you. Thank you. It's a pretty amazing thing to be involved in.
I got there first.
It was awesome.
I got 200 first, but that's okay. You only get
one. Actually, Bill got to 200 first.
Yeah.
And it should be noted that both of your programs owe their existence to Bill Pasternack.
Yeah, that's
right.
Because he was there first by about 30 years.
Yes.
And to go on that a little bit more, I'm going to say Bob Heil actually reached out to Bill Pasternack several times to ask for ways to improve the show and how to make things better. And Bill was always no bars hold. I mean, he gave out everything he thought about it. So Bob took a lot of that advice and improved on it as well. So, and the 200 show was a blast. So you guys, it's been really nice to join you all tonight, and thank you for some of your great stories. I wish I could stick around and catch up with the rest of it, but I'll tune in and watch the show again. So Skeeter and Jim and Rich, really nice to meet you for the first time. Of course, Don, I'll see you Wednesday. And Gary, yes, thanks so much for having me on tonight.
It's a pleasure. I don't think we've actually talked live on Skype before. I think we, because I was heading away from Ham Nation as you were coming in, so I don't think we crossed over quite.
Okay, so, that might be right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this is great. Well, I'm going to let you push your hang up button, because if I push it from this end, I'm going to lose everybody.
Well, we don't want to do that. No. You guys have a great night, and God bless, Bill.
And say hi to Bob and George and Gordon for me.
Will. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Good night, Amanda.
Bye, Amanda.
Okay, looks like we'll have the ghost of Amanda sitting over there in the corner for a while. Skeeter, you have been patiently waiting for your chance to talk about how far you go back and tell us a Bill story or two. So let me promote you to center screen and go for it.
Thank you, Gary. Actually, I a relative short time of knowing Bill. I got licensed at the end of 2010, November 29th, 2010, got my technician ticket. Within a couple of months, I had upgraded to general. And within about the same amount of time, I got elected president of the Northeast Arkansas Radio Club. I was living in Jonesboro at the time. Barely licensed 2 months. They said, we got to get some new blood in here. So elected.
They do that to new hams because you don't know any better.
Well, yeah. But it was a great honor, and it was great fun. And we made so many good friends in that club. And as a matter of fact, we're going to be traveling over to join them again for field day, as we've done ever since we left Arkansas. We've come back to that for field day to be with that club, because they're just such great folks. But our club decided to put on a special event station. Now, Jonesboro is about 50 miles or so north of Johnny Cash's hometown that he grew up in, down on the Mississippi Delta, Dice, Arkansas, the Dice Colony. If you saw the film Walk the Line, some of the early scenes in Johnny's life were portrayed, were actually filmed there in the Dice area. So that's what it looked like. And his 80th birthday celebration was coming up. Johnny had passed, of course, years ago. But we decided, I'm just crazy enough to say, hey, folks in the club, let's do a special event station honoring Johnny Cash, since we're in such good proximity to his hometown. So we put it together, and in the pre-publicity, getting the word out, I sent a press release to Bill, hoping that it might get featured in a Newsline story. Well, he got back to me and he said, you're a broadcaster, right? And I said, yeah. He said, why don't you just voice the story and send it to us? I said, okay, works for me. He said, I'll write the script. Don't worry about it. I'll write the script. I'll send it to you. And you just send it back. Okay. So that's what I did. And he was pleased with it. And he sent me a couple of other stories to do. And I said, you know, here was where I may have made what could be considered the fatal mistake. I said, Bill, if you ever need another anchor, you know, I'd love to do the longer form and anchor the show sometime. He said, you got it. So within a couple of weeks, here comes an email. Can you anchor this week? Sure. So I did. And it just went on from there. And I became one of the random rotating group of anchors of Newsline. And that was my connection. That started in 2011. So that's, you know, relatively short time that I got to know Bill. Well, fast forward about a year. It's my final few months in Arkansas before I moved down to Texas for a couple of years. And now I'm in Topeka, Kansas. Been here since October of last year. Well, a fellow ham in Northeast Arkansas was getting ready to go to Dayton. And it just so happened that he has his own plane. And he and his son, pretty much every year, who also was licensed and was getting his pilot's license, they would fly up to Dayton on Friday, spend the night, go hang out at the hamvention, and then fly back Saturday night. And Terry said to me, there's an empty seat. It won't cost you anything. It costs me no more to get you in that seat than if it was empty. So would you like to go to Dayton? I said, let me think about it. Yes. And and so I climbed in that plane and we took off and went up to Dayton. And I got up there and I'm just, you know, like anybody who's ever gone to Dayton for the first time, you're just overwhelmed. Once we got into the convention hall, it was just amazing. Once we got into Harrah Arena, well, one of the first things I knew I wanted to do, and I'd been in touch with Bill, I let him know, hey, I've got this lightning trip to Dayton that's been offered to me, so I'm going to go. And he said, okay, I'll set you up with some or get a hold of the people in charge, and we'll set you up with some press credentials. So, okay, I'll be a roving reporter for Amateur Radio Newsline while I'm here. And got to the Hamvention. And one of the first areas I tried to find, because, of course, it's a maze in that place, but I did find Audio Alley. I found the Newsline setup and right there next to the Heil booth. And who do I run into but my friend Don Wilbanks? And I was admiring his I'm a Ham Nation fan pin, which those were the new thing back then. And the sign guy was putting those out. And I said, man, I'd love to get one of those. And he said, here, take mine. So I said, no, you don't have to do that. He said, no, I can get some more. So he gave me his Ham Nation fan pin. I still have it. I wear it proudly at any Hamvention or convention. What am I trying to say? Hamfest. That's the word. I'm stuck on Hamvention. Hamfest that I've gone to. So we chatted for a while. And then I met Bob while I was there. Got my picture taken with Bob, which was very cool. And then I found the Dayton, the Ham Amateur Radio Newsline forum, the town hall meeting that was going on. And got in there and introduced myself to Bill. It's nice to meet you face to face. And of course, he was rushing around getting everything ready to go. And I sat in the audience and enjoyed the town hall immensely. That was the year that Erin was the Young Ham of the Year, and she was incredibly impressive. She was like the keynote speaker for the whole thing. And Rich, I believe you were there as well. I don't know that we actually met, but I was in the hall and got to hang out with everybody there that day. And it was just a marvelous thing. And it just Bill instantly made me feel like I was part of the Ham the Amateur Radio Newsline family. It was just a great thing. He was so gracious. And from there, it was just he kept sending me scripts and I kept doing them. And then when he fell ill this last year, you know, he like I said, he put the call out and I responded earlier this year. And I, for the first time, edited together a newscast and tried to keep it up and going through all those weeks and the last couple of months. And so that's my connection with Bill. I do have one funny story because we did talk quite a bit on the phone and on Skype especially. And he was regaling me with some of his great stories of Broadway and shows that he had gone to see. And he told me of going to see one of the dress rehearsals, I believe it was, for the original production of West Side Story.
Yeah, we hadn't mentioned that, but that was one of his great loves in life, was New York theater. It probably killed him to move to L.A.
Yeah, I'm sure. But I think he tried to catch as much out there as he could, too, in the way of live theater. But one of the funniest stories he ever told me was he was working somewhere in L.A. Maybe it was when he was at KTTV. I'm not too sure. But he said that for about 2 weeks or so, he would get on the 405 freeway. And, of course, the traffic in L.A. was just horrible. He'd be going to work. And about the same time they'd be in a traffic jam, he would look over and see a convertible in a lane next to him. And he noticed the man driving the car had looked familiar. Turned and looked at him, realized it was Mel Brooks. And so they nodded and waved to each other. Well, for some reason, Mel Brooks' schedule coincided with Bill's for several days on end, and they would wind up invariably being within proximity to each other in this traffic jam on the 405 freeway. Well, one day, Bill is talking on his mobile rig. He's got the mic going and everything, and here comes Mel Brooks pulling up beside him. And Mel kind of motions to him, what are you doing? What are you doing? So Bill rolls down the window, and Mel Brooks in that voice of his says, what's that you doing over there? And Bill tells him, it's ham radio. And without missing a beat, Mel Brooks says, "That's not kosher." I laughed for about 5 minutes when he told me that story. I about fell out of my chair. I thought only Mel Brooks could instantly come up with a retort like that, and it was That's just hilarious. And then they just went on their way, you know.
And now Bill,
only in L.A.
Bill wasn't just a fan of New York theater; he knew everybody there.
Yeah,
or at least to hear him tell it, he knew everybody. I'm assuming he did.
He did.
How a TV repairman makes all those personal contacts with big stars, I don't know, but he did.
It's because of Brooklyn.
Yeah.
Because the people that he grew up with in Brooklyn, among them were many people who went on to be in the theater. So a lot of the actors and actresses that are out in Broadway theater today and for the last 30, 40 years also grew up in Brooklyn and were people he knew in high school.
So it's I knew them when.
Yes, and he was the ultimate networker and
no kidding.
Kept in contact with everybody from the old neighborhood.
Yeah. His tentacles reach everywhere. Everybody knows who he is. So I want to move on to a couple other things. But first, before we recorded this, the guy that may go back the farthest, I'm not quite sure, but the guy who may go back the farthest is the actual founder, along with Bill, of Newsline, Jim Hendershot. Jim is in Denmark, so time schedule's too late to be on here now, but he called me earlier today, and he's also in a bandwidth-free zone. I think I explained all this in the interview, so let's take a couple minutes, and I'm going to play the conversation I had earlier today with Newsline's founder, and we'll hear some stories about how things got started with Jim Hendershot. So, Jim, thank you very much for joining the program from a distant location. You are a rare DX. You are what, in Denmark, did you say?
Yes, I am in Denmark, about 40 kilometers north of Copenhagen.
Okay, so we have... we've called you early in advance because the rest of the program will be being recorded somewhere in the middle of the night for you. And you're also in a bandwidth-free zone. So we're doing telephone, not Skype and no video, but people can see what you look like. The picture that I've got up here is with you in a blue shirt and a patterned tie and a map behind you. It seems to be the most ubiquitous one on the internet. Is that what you still look like today?
More or less, although I don't wear the tie nearly so often.
Okay. So what I wanted to do is get your impressions of the way Newsline got started. But first, are you still in regular contact? Were you still in regular contact with Bill, or had it been a while since you talked to him?
Oh, it had been a little while, but I generally, we kept in touch a couple, three times a year at least, and sometimes more often, depending on what was going on. Usually we would run into each other at Dayton, although I haven't been to Dayton for a couple of years now, so I haven't seen him since the last time I was at Dayton with him. he had some issues at that point, health-wise, but I didn't expect, to be honest, I didn't expect this.
Okay, so this came as a surprise to you.
Yes, it did.
Yeah, I guess in the conversations that I'd had with him, I could tell he was having trouble. And when he was in the hospital, things were not going well going back and forth. But I think all of us were surprised with the timing. So let's go back to the beginning with you and Bill. I know you started with the Newsline, which at the time was called Westlink, in 1977. Did you know Bill before that?
Yeah, he and I ran into him on 2 meters, we used to chit-chat. I think it was on the Mount Lee repeater back in those days. And then eventually he got on the, I built a 220 repeater, and he was on that as well. And at that time, they had all these repeater rules. You had WR calls, and you had to file all kinds of paperwork, and it was a real big nightmare to get a repeater up. And then the FCC decided to deregulate the whole mess. And by that point, there were several repeaters that were in this loosely confederated group of linking things called Westlink, the Western Linking System. And so we decided to put out a bulletin about the deregulation. And Bill had the wonderful idea of, well, let's make it sort of like a newscast. Let's be professional about this and make it interesting to people.
Okay, so first of all, that's where the Westlink name came from the linking
that's
system.
That's correct.
And yes. the newscast was Bill's idea.
Yeah, well, the idea was to take, originally I said we should put a bulletin out, and Bill said, let's do better than that and make it a newscast. And so we got with another guy, and we did some taping and editing and all kinds of stuff. Bill wrote up some scripts and called some people and interviewed some people, and I read the script, and I think it was 25 minutes long. It was really quite an endeavor for a one-shot item. And we put it out on the various repeaters and some simplex channels, and it was very well received. And the next week, there's this particular net on 220 megahertz, and the next week the net came on, and everybody said, "So where's the news?" And that was the only broadcast that we ever missed was the second one, because we really weren't planning on one, and everybody was expecting it. So the next week after that, we had one, and I think it's run continuously without any interruption ever since.
Yeah, no interruptions until Bill went into the hospital and wasn't able to produce them toward the end of last year. Most of the folks in this audience are going to be somewhat contemporary with us, you know, in their 50s, 60s, and they're going to remember back before the internet and before information distribution was fast and easy. But the environment that you were in back then was the FCC would come out with a report and order, and it wouldn't appear in full detail in QST for months. And there was a newsletter called HR Report, which was an attempt to get at least the headlines out in a timely manner. It was mailed first class, but it was one page, and so it couldn't have any details. So how did you get the information? And I guess the idea was then you wanted to be able to disseminate it. Well, W1AW also had very short bulletins at the time. So once again, no details. So how did you guys get the full details, and what was your thought on getting that distributed?
Well, the way we got the details, Bill was really heavily responsible for sleuthing out the news, but we had a lot of people in a lot of places that were somehow involved in whatever the issue was. They would call Bill, and Bill would do telephone interviews, and or they'd call me, and I would do telephone interviews, or I'd call them, or Bill would call them. It was this big back and forth thing. And then every week, I would sit down with all of the stuff and edit it, and then and read the script, and Bill would write some stuff, and I would write some stuff. It was a big interactive deal. And eventually we would produce a broadcast on quarter inch open reel tape. And then we would copy that to cassettes, and a few people would call in, and we would feed it to them. I would feed it to them live. Tape delayed, but I mean, they would call in and I would turn the tape recorder on, and we'd patch it down the phone line. And eventually we built an automated system where you just call into this phone number and you could get it that way. And the whole idea was to make it much more up-to-date and contemporary and fast. And it worked out quite nicely. And what would happen is somebody would go to a Hamfest, and there'd be an FCC guy there, and you would, they would interview them and that sort of thing. And you get the latest and greatest, straight from the horse's mouth.
So this was Bill's attempt, anyway, at making a really serious broadcast news program. Had you been involved in broadcast media? You're certainly not doing that now.
No, I'm not doing that now. That was a previous life.
So you were.
I started off. Yeah, early on, I was in small market radio, and then I moved back to the LA area and wound up eventually working for American Broadcasting Company. And the pressure in broadcasting is, as anybody who's been there for a while will tell you, it can be pretty severe. And I didn't take well to that. So I got out of that and went into the mobile telephone business. This was pre-cellular. And that got me into the career I'm in now, which is in RF and wireless design. But I've always had a soft spot in my heart for broadcasting. And so, I kept in touch with Bill. I would occasionally drop a news story in or something like that. But that became less and less frequent because I was more or less, I moved to Oregon. I moved to a rural place in Oregon. There weren't very many ham radio stories there, so not much happened, that kind of thing.
So you did the program for what, about 2 years?
Yeah, it was right around 2 years. And then life gets in the way sometimes. I got married, and my wife had kids already, so it became a very fast, got to learn how to do this. Oh, my goodness, I've got to get a job. And then I lost my job in Southern California, and we moved. I moved up to the Central Coast area near Pismo Beach. Got disinvolved pretty quickly. Bill took things over and just ran with it. And it grew. And he had some really good announcers in those early days that helped him, both in interviewing and on-air reading. So it wasn't a big adjustment. In fact, it moved the entire broadcast forward quite a bit to be freed from just one person and have a group of people do it. And Bill coordinated that very nicely.
Were you surprised that it kept on going until now?
No, I was not. Okay, the longevity of it has surprised me a little bit, but knowing Bill and his tenacity, it really didn't surprise me very much. Bill was very competent at what he was doing there and just had a real love for ham radio, and it showed in his service to the amateur community in this way.
Now, this was something that was unusual in ham radio. We've had rules that prohibited broadcasting, rules that prohibited music, and rules that permitted bulletins of interest to amateur radio operators, but they typically took the form of a W1AW, something that only ran for a few minutes, and very quick headlines out of QST. What kind of reaction did you get? It sounded like, for one thing, when they said the second week, where's the news? That at least the folks in your repeater group were happy to hear it. But what was the rest of the reaction? And did you get pushback on, this isn't ham radio?
Well, it's funny you say that, because we actually did have a very humorous incident with that. after a few weeks of this, I became relatively well-known, as did Bill, for doing this, and it started spreading all over the country. At the time, the American Radio Relay League was, less than progressive. And so they were not happy about this. And we were at a Hamfest in Santa Maria, and there was one of our guys in the repeater group that was doing interviews. Nobody knew who he was, which was a good thing. So he went up and he interviewed the president of the league at the time, and it was kind of funny because he had no idea he was with Westlink or Newsline. And he said, so what do you think of this? And the guy says, oh, this is illegal. We're going to be filing a complaint with the FCC and all this other nonsense. He was just upset. And, we've talked to legal counsel and it's totally illegal. And, the FCC is going to shut this down. Well, at that convention, he was the head of the amateur division of the FCC. And so he went and interviewed him. And the guy says, oh, yeah, I've heard of this. I think it's wonderful. And there's totally nothing wrong with it because it's news of information designed to be sent to amateurs. And so, therefore, it's not a broadcast to the general public. So it's not illegal. And so we had these two pieces of tape, and Bill masterfully cut these things together and wrote a script, and it just really made the league look really silly. And it was one of our few pokes that was really seriously bad at the ARRL. And it was pretty hilarious because, of course, you know, after that, the league shut up completely. They didn't want to embarrass themselves any further than that. And, you know, ultimately now the league is much more accepting of these things.
And they're doing their own. And they have been now for some time.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yep. How about other hams? Did you get any trouble from just the general population, or did everybody seem to say, I don't know what it is, but I like it?
Generally speaking, I think that was the reaction. It was a new thing. There were occasional one-off comments of, you know, I'm not sure about this, or is this legal, or whatever. But, you know, we were very careful to stay within the boundaries of the rule. We didn't use music. We didn't, you know, I mean, that would have been interesting to have, you know, some kind of really cool little theme song or something. But, you know, you can't do that. And so we were very circumspect and made sure that we never violated the rules. And because of that, we really didn't get a lot of pushback. The general amateur community was actually quite happy with it. And there were very few people, hardly at all, that resisted at all. So it was kind of nice that way.
Getting the information in that era was one thing. Getting the broadcast out to anybody who wanted it was another technical issue. How did you guys accomplish that?
Well, in the early days, as I said, we used cassettes, and we would do live feed, you know, live being me with a tape recorder and a phone patch. But eventually it became clear we needed to do something more sophisticated than that. So the first thing that we did is we clutched together a quarter-inch tape recorder with automatic rewind and, shut off and everything else. And we made it so that if you called into a certain phone number, it would just simply start that tape, play that tape. When it got done, it would hang up and rewind the tape and be ready for the next caller. That got more sophisticated. Bill, when he took over the thing full time, managed to scrounge a broadcast cartridge machine, tape cartridge machine. And the thing worked that way, and it progressed from there. And eventually, of course, it became an internet broadcast, and that, you know, the whole thing worked out nicely. But for years, telephone was the big way to get it out. You know, there were a number of telephone outlets that were essentially rebroadcasts of the original that were sponsored by various hams around the country, and that was extremely helpful because it made it easier. You didn't have this huge load on one phone line. It just made it much nicer.
The internet solved a lot of problems and probably made it a lot less expensive, but it was a couple of decades before that came around and became seriously available for us. For you, and I remember talking to Bill about this time last year on BS number one from Ham Radio Now, that he was still getting requests for the dial-up system. So even though... We're in the middle of the internet. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. I remember as recently as like maybe a year and a half, 2 years ago, he was contacting me saying, is there an easy way to build something that listens to an MP3 on a like a USB stick that I can plug into the thing for the phone? And I'm like, trying to figure something out because it was such a pain in the neck to have to transfer it to whatever format. I think he was using an automated answering machine thing. And I don't remember what the format was, but it was not, I think he had to do it, cross it over manually or something. And I was thinking to myself, in this day and age, why do we even care? But, you know, there was still a lot of demand for it.
Trying to kludge modern technology into ancient technology. And there's still some hams, hams that don't even have computers, so.
I still have old tube gear, so.
Yep. And everybody could listen to this on the internet themselves, download it and stuff, and do it as soon as the broadcast was out. Probably a lot of people were still just waiting for it to appear on their local repeater.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's almost an event, you know. There are a lot of repeaters to this day where there'll be the local club will have a net, and at the end of the net follows the broadcast. And, you know, I think part of that is that there is a communal nature to amateur radio that still has not changed. And so people are, still meet for nets, and there's that becomes an opportunity. That net becomes an opportunity for them to get a little piece of the news without having to, okay, now I got to go to my computer and turn this on. Oh, do I really want to spend the time on this? I don't know. But if you're already there for a net, it becomes an easy segue to go in and get and listen to the news.
All right. Well, Jim, thank you very much for giving us some information on the way these things got started, or Newsline got started. And now I will get back to the rest of my group, and maybe we'll see where it is going to go. So thanks very much. And are you on vacation? Are you over there on business?
Oh, I'm on vacation visiting family. My wife is from Denmark, and so I'm here to visit family. I've got kids and grandkids who are coming along in a few days, and we're going to show them Denmark for the first time. So that'll be nice. Well, one of my son-in-law and the kids, but my daughter's been here many times. So that works out nicely.
That sounds like fun. And I know I'm keeping you up late. So thank you so much. And we'll keep in touch.
No problem. My pleasure, Gary.
73.
This is therapy for the soul. And I need it.
Yeah.
I seriously right. need it.
Well, Jim is fast asleep right now. Again... Jim Hendershot, not Jim Davis.
Jim.
Yeah, the other Jim.
I guess I may have dozed slightly.
Yeah, he's on vacation in Denmark and having a good time.
Are you
time.
Finished drying the dishes for your wife now, Davis?
No, actually, she's still banging the plates over there, if you can hear me.
Yeah, your mic is good. Good sensitive mic. So,
iPhone rocks.
What I'd like to do, look at what we've got assembled here. Ladies and gentlemen of the Ham Radio Now audience, big time broadcasters. I mean, big time broadcasters here.
Well, one of us is. But it ain't me.
Well, there's big time, and then there's bigger time, and we're covering the gamut. And then there's me, whose last job was at a 1,000-watt daytimer in a small town in Arizona. But
you're sounding like Ted Baxter now. You know, I actually do. I open my morning show every morning here on the station I work at here in Topeka, and I've opened my shows for years with a snippet of Ted Knight as Ted Baxter on the Mary Tyler Moore Show saying, "It all started in a 5,000-watt radio station in Fresno, California. A $65 paycheck and a crazy dream." And that's a little tip of the hat to my original birthplace of Fresno, California. That sounded like Ted Baxter to me.
Let me try this, because I do have one claim to fame, one national commercial that got my voice on it, a series actually. And it's what paid for a good deal of the stuff that you see around me here, because God knows Ham Radio Now is not paying for it. This may sound familiar to you. Travelocity presents The Roaming Gnome, denouncer of travel myths.
No kidding.
That was
wow,
me.
Wow, that was you?
That was me.
Wow.
And the way I describe it is when I was coming up with that voice, I was the engineer for a mixing session, an audition session. We were bringing in talent from New York and Los Angeles, and everyone was giving it their shot. And the producer didn't like it very much. And the agency that I was working at is an audio engineer. We all do scratch tracks now and then. And I'd had some minor radio background. So I had a better idea what they were looking for than the folks that they were talking to and giving 30 seconds to do an audition. So the way I describe it was a combination or a cross between Movie Tone News and Ted Baxter.
Mm-hmm.
And it came out, Travelocity presents The Roaming Gnome, denouncer of travel myths. And I got the gig.
Gary, that's how that story kind of parallels how, and we're getting off track a little bit, but I wanted to share this. That's how Don LaFontaine got his start. And Don LaFontaine was a guy who wrote a bunch of copy for radio or TV commercials back in the day. And the talent, I think, didn't come in. And they said, well, why don't you try it? And that was the beginning of...
In a world.
Yeah. Right.
Everybody, so everybody try your best.
Go on YouTube and just and search Don LaFontaine. That's yeah. I go on there and he's my hero. So
yeah. He's in
that's a neat story.
A documentary called I Know That Voice.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And I think he gets a little bit of some time on there was a movie, and now I can't remember the name of the movie. Fairly recent movie about voiceover people.
Yeah. He did a Geico commercial too.
Yeah.
Yeah. I remember that. Geico commercial. Standing in the kitchen, the woman's kitchen.
Right. Okay. And I hired a narrator. Exactly. Well,
so everybody and, do you your know, best in a
it's
world.
It's interesting because a guy who's kind of carried on in Don's, Don LaFontaine's tradition is Bo Weaver.
Right.
K6KHJ.
Right.
Bo was a boss jock back in the days. Maybe he came on in right after Boss Radio kind of faded, but he was on 93KHJ, which was a monster radio station in Los Angeles in the mid-1960s. And he now does lots of – I'm sorry? What was that?
I worked there also at KHJ. Yeah.
Did you really?
Yeah.
I am reading Ron Jacobs' book right now, and it is amazing, all the stories of KHJ, because – Boss Radio was also in my hometown of Fresno, California. That's what I wanted to get on the radio because of 13 Kino, K-Y-N-O. I went to school at Sacred Heart School right next door to Kino. I literally grew up in the shadow of Kino's towers.
Did you say wonderful Wino? No, that was different.
It was a Kino number one, golden. You know, I mean, they had the great the a cappella jingles. Johnny Mann singers.
Yeah. Yeah. Johnny Mann and Pam's, yeah.
Yep, it was just fantastic.
So Rich Moseson
got me hooked on radio.
Rich Moseson, you were not an on-air talent, but you
Well,
have...
actually, I was a long time ago. I started out in radio news.
Ah, which little radio station or a network?
Little 500-watt radio station in Spring Valley, New York, WKQW. And then went to the thriving metropolis of Beacon, New York, and worked for WBNR and WSPK, and did some stringing for ABC when I was at BNR, and then when I was writing for the Associated Press, I would periodically do some pieces on the AP Radio Network. So.
And by the way, Bill would love these stories.
Oh, yeah.
Just eat them up.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm going somewhere with this. And and Rich, I think I've talked to you about this on previous programs. I talked to Bill on previous programs about this sort of thing. And we're looking at the ham radio outreach to the general public, which is abysmal. The programs that Bill and Alan Call and Dave W6AQ, I should be able to.
Bell.
Dave Bell, Bell. Worked on, notwithstanding that too few of them and too far between, we've done pretty bad job of making stuff for the general public of ham radio. And now I've wondered why. Now I know why. Bill Pasternack sucked all you guys up into Newsline. There was nobody left.
There's a lot of truth to that, I'm sure. Yeah.
But, you know, if I could offer up an observation, Gary, Bill and all those great folks that teamed up with him for those presentations, they started doing those back in the film days, you know, 35 millimeter, 16 millimeter film days, very expensive to produce and to assemble and edit something like that and put it out there for the public. Now, look at what we've got. Look at how far we've come. You've got your show. You've got Ham Nation. There are any number of other video podcasts that are out there available. You know, George Thomas and his crew do such a great job with theirs. And I mean, I honestly, if I had the time through the week to watch all the amateur radio video podcasts that I would really like to watch on a weekly basis, I'd have to quit my job.
Yeah.
And my wife would probably throw me out, and then I wouldn't be able to watch anyway. So, you know, I have to balance things. But we do have that now, and it's so much less expensive to grab a GoPro camera or any other decent camera. Or for crying out loud, I shot some video at Austin. Yeah, there you go. I shot some video at the Austin Summerfest last year and produced it, you know, put it together with iMovie. It was basically a slideshow, kind of like what you guys did with Bill's tribute, some still photos and a little bit of video mixed in. But I kind of did it on the fly, fairly short order, and sent it off. And Dale put it up on Ham Nation on the video segment. And, you know, these days it's a lot easier for us to get the word out. We just need to find a way to attract people to come and look at these videos and to come and see the events that we're doing, things like Field Day, a great opportunity to reach out to the public. But I've tried lots of different ways. I've encouraged radio stations I've worked at the last few years to run some of the ARRL produced PSAs, and there's some good ones. I mean, Johnny Donovan, great voice talent, who just retired from WABC in New York City. Who's also a ham. He and a very familiar voice to Rush Limbaugh listeners. He's kind of the voice of Rush's show. He's done several PSAs over the years for the ARRL that are very well produced. And so I've tried to get him to run those. As a matter of fact, I just gave a couple to our webmaster at the station I'm working at now to put on the stream for the local club here, the Kaw Valley Amateur Radio Club, for their Field Day event coming up. They requested that I put a tag on those, which I did for the local event. And now we're running those on our stream. Sorry, running those on our stream. And there's just... I think that probably, if you think about it, the not to argue or debate with you, about
which
it,
you may but, do, and please do.
Well, I just think maybe it's a matter of who's going to do it. It's kind of like when Bill said, we need somebody to edit Newsline. I am in a hospital. I can't do it. You know, can somebody do it? And like I said, I kind of waited because I thought I don't know that I really have the time to take this on.
Yeah.
But when I saw that everybody else was busy too, well, somebody's got to do it. And I've got an iMac and I've got Pro Tools and I've got Audacity. I've got all kinds of ways to edit. I can do it six ways to Sunday. And so that was the beginning of getting it back up and running. And I imagine, much to my wife's chagrin, her call sign is KF5KRN, by the way. I thought I'd throw that in. Much to her frustration, just because she knows how limited my time is and how here it is that I should already be in bed because I get up at 3 a.m. to do a morning show. And right just a few weeks after I volunteered to start editing the show and putting it together and producing the final product again, our program director left, and they asked me to step into his position. So now I'm not only doing a morning show, I'm also taking on all the programming duties for the radio station. And that just added several hours to my day. So it became even harder for me to do the production of Newsline, which is why the last few episodes were getting out a little bit later and a little bit later each week. And I felt badly about that. I wanted to make that Friday deadline, but sometimes it was Saturday morning. So, you know,
let me hear what you're going to sound like tomorrow morning with not quite enough sleep. I know when I was doing a morning show and I stayed up too late, what I sounded like, and it was pathetic.
Well, you know, it's I can kind of do my Lay King impression. Hi, this is Lay King in Washington, and we go now to Bono, Arkansas for Ross Perot. Hello.
Topeka, line three.
What's the question?
Well, good points. People are busy, but there are so many broadcasters in ham radio that have not stepped up to do something like this. A lot of people will point their finger at ARRL, and ARRL did fund to the, and as Bill and I have talked very candidly, to the tune of just barely enough to cover the expenses and not really what the programs are worth, some of the films that Bill and Alan and Dave made. So it seems like, you know, somewhere in there, we need to do better.
Gary, don't you think, though, it takes one-on-one mentoring? I mean, I think back to my roots in, you know, I learned Morse code in Boy Scouts. I learned it all the wrong way. I learned it as dots and dashes because I wanted to win a merit badge, you know. But I was walking home from school one day, and the local YMCA said, get your ham radio license here on its front billboard. And I walked in, and there was a guy by the name of George Downs, who was a ham. He became my first Elmer, and he was the guy who sat and gave me the novice test. And then 6 months later, he was the guy who prompted me for my general ticket back in the late 50s. You know, I don't think things have really changed. Now, I think, ham radio tends to be
incestuous, I guess. We all are a group that talks amongst each other, but we don't necessarily reach out as we could to promulgate the hobby. I'll give you an interesting thing about my grandson was here over the weekend, and my son is a ham. He's K4SMD. My wife is a ham. She's K4PAG. And a couple of years ago, I was had my grandson, who at the time was about 7 years old, and he and I were on 10 meters together. I brought him up to the ham shack, and we made a contact with a fellow who was working from a state park up in Michigan. And we didn't know this at the time, but he had a video camera running, and he videotaped our QSO and then posted it on YouTube. And I was able to send that to my grandson because he talked on the mic, and here he was coming through this radio in a distant location far, far away. And it really fascinated him. And over the weekend, we played with a new D-Star repeater in town, and we talked to a fellow over in England. And I can tell you that my grandson's eyes lit up at 8 years old, or 8 or 9 years old, with this thrill of something that all of a sudden became not an old man's hobby, but something that was sexy again. And I think that's what we have to do. I think it is a matter of winning people over one by one and that means for us, it doesn't take a national agency to do that, I don't think. And I think all the great PSAs in the world sound good, but if you're going to entice somebody, I think it takes that personal contact to light up the bulb that gives them the rush of being able to join the excitement of what you and I and all of us on this call and the people listening, we already know it. It's I remember when who was it? Oh, it was it was one of the classic rock singers once that said, you know, it was during the days of early rock radio and the people who listened. Oh, I know it was Frank Zappa. Frank Zappa once said, if I wanted to get the message to the people who need to get the message, I would sing country songs, which I thought was a great saying. The people that were listening to his
Skeeter's going, what?
Yeah, his underground music at the time. Yeah, the people that listened to Frank Zappa at the time, they already had the message. They knew the message. You know, yeah. He needed to reach out was his point. So that's my point.
Quit preaching to the choir.
Yeah, there's no question that
but we have to start with the choir because a big part of our problem is our self-perception, and there are far too many hams who see the hobby and portray the hobby as an old man's hobby, a dying hobby. You know, you see news reports about ham radio and managing to survive, and where do the reporters get all this? They get it from the hams that they're interviewing. We have to start with the hams themselves and our own self-image. We have to do a better job of persuading ourselves and each other that what we do really is exciting, really is cool. You know, my editorial in the July issue is titled Kid Magnets. And it's about an experience I just had a couple of weeks ago going to a Mini Maker Fair. And I had a bunch of projects set up, and I was part of a larger maker group here in New Jersey. And they had, you know, a drone that was with a camera in it that you put on a virtual reality helmet, and the guy who built it was hand flying it around the room, and you were like in it. And there were a whole bunch of other stuff. There were two things that drew everybody's attention. The virtual reality helmet with the drone and telegraph keys. The kids could not walk past my display without walking up to a key and going. Because it fascinated them.
Totally different ends of the spectrum.
Totally different ends of the spectrum, but it was a magnet. I had two different keys, one that you just heard was an old sound wire telegraph key and sounder, and another hooked up to an oscillator. And the kids couldn't keep their hands off them. We have to get into our own heads that this is cool stuff that we do. This is fun stuff. This is exciting stuff. And we have to manage to figure out a way to package and relay our own enthusiasm about what we do in ham radio to other people. and stop telling people that it's a dying hobby filled with old men, because it's not.
Yeah, that doesn't help.
And to bring the discussion back around to Bill, you know.
Bill who? Oh, yeah, Bill.
Bill Pasternack, yeah. He probably would have said Bill who if he was here. The last video project that I know of that he did was the DIY magic of amateur radio, which was right. trying to bring things into the 21st century, trying to right. show the makers and hackers generation, hey, this is really cool stuff. This is tech, you know, to the nth degree, if you want to take it that far. So I think, you know, Bill was definitely trying to stay cutting edge with that. And again, Rich, like you said, the ARRL, or maybe it was Don, I forget who said it now, about the funding, you know, just barely giving enough budget to make it happen. But they did make it happen. And I thought it was pretty well presented, and hopefully maybe at least a few young people kind of paid attention to it.
Yeah, they got a bargain on that program. And it tags into what Jim was saying, is that we can attract people if we do some good promotion, but it's not going to do any good if we don't have the follow-up, the individual one-on-one.
True. Yep.
Another question, talking about attracting young people and the media environment that we're in. There are literally now dozens, maybe more than dozens, of online technology programs and even networks. And I don't have a survey of every possible one of them. But of the ones that I know, one of them has a ham radio show. And Don, that's the one that you're on. It's TWiT, Ham Nation.
TWiT, yeah.
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 Yep. There's 5x5, Guys from Queens, as big as CNET, as small as Geek's Life. And best I can tell, those guys are totally unaware that ham radio exists. You know there's hams working for them.
Yeah, and you would think that those guys, I'm sure that they, well, I would hope that they all watch the competition. I mean, you know, as broadcasters, even or podcasters, you kind of have to be aware of what your competition is doing. And TWiT is, I think, probably arguably or unarguably the big dog, the big cat in the fight. Right. Yeah. You know that they're all watching what they're doing. And Ham Nation is, I think, in the top five of the landed programs on TWiT. You would have to think that they're maybe looking at doing something, one would think. I don't know.
Well, it's a chicken and egg demographic. The demographic for Ham Nation is going to be old.
Right.
Sorry, Rich.
But to their credit, I will say that they've changed, they've adapted, and I noticed that right away when they started bringing in folks like Amanda and some of the obviously younger faces. I mean, you know, Bob and Gordo, they're elder statesmen of amateur radio, and I don't think they would mind me saying that because that's meant with complete respect, absolute respect.
Yeah.
But again, attracting younger people, they want to see some faces that look a little bit more like theirs. And so I think that bringing in Amanda and some of the younger folks who have started to filter in on occasion to Ham Nation have broadened the demographic hopefully quite a bit. And they must be doing something right, because obviously the advertisers followed. And I'm pretty sure, Don, you may be privy to some of the more of the information for the advertisers on the show, that they must be getting results, because several of them have been on there with the show for ever since I've started seeing advertisements included as part of the show.
Yeah, we had a brand new sponsor, as a matter of fact, last Wednesday, an eyewear company. And they do prescription eyewear and sunglasses. And I got an email from them today going, my God, they loved everything that you and George did. I mean, it was me, George, and Bob all had the glasses on, and they said, "We loved the style. We loved everything that you did, and it's just they loved it." So obviously, we're getting eyeglass companies as sponsors. We're getting, a razor company.
Yeah,
Blade.
I was an electric shaver for 20 years.
Yeah.
And when you gave you did one a while back where you said it's kind of like cigar smoking. It's the experience of it.
It is.
And I can relate to that because I also enjoy an occasional cigar. So, you know, I related totally to that, and I thought, well, you know, I'm going to give it a try. So I did, and I've been using their product for about 2 months now.
Yeah, that's Harry's, and I'm a Harry's user now too.
I've had people come up to me at Hamfest and go, "You made me a Harry's man." I got a Harry's is getting a great plug right now, but I got a QSL card the other day that said, "Thanks for making me a Harry's man." I'm like, "Oh, this is cool." Yeah. And by the way, if you heard the voice in the background, that was my wife calling on the phone telling me she's on her way from work. So, okay, honey, see you in a bit.
She'll see this tomorrow night or something. I'll say that I'm buying Harry's because it's as good as, and maybe slightly better than the double the price competition in the grocery store. I'm not one of those guys that's going to say, "Whoa, it's the best shave I've ever had. It's amazing. Yeah. It's changed my life." That's not true. It's a good shave. And it's a lot less expensive. So
I saw a shootout, not to harp on Harry's, but I saw a shootout of a competition of high-end blades and these mail-order blades like that, and Harry's won. So
yeah, it could very well be. It's not like Head and Shoulders. You know, I'm not sure where I would come out in a blind test, you know, if I'd pick it or not. Yeah. But it's good.
Yeah. It is.
And I don't like shaving.
As the bearded one in the group, back to Bill.
You heathen.
To me, all I see is a round dot and a kind of hunched shoulders. But
oh, that's him. That's Rich. Yeah.
You'll see that tomorrow night, Rich, when the show
in the witness protection program.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. And so by the way,
witless protection program.
Yeah. What that's all about is that we have discovered in this, my first attempt at getting more than two people on a Skype call at once, is that you can't do group calls to iPads. And, Skype is a Microsoft company and not the world's most accommodating to Apple. So I didn't know this would be the case. That's why we're hearing Jim and Rich and not seeing them, because they have video, but I could show them to you one at a time, but not as a group. So Timothy, Skeeter, and Don are evidently on PCs, or they would work with Macs, just not the handheld devices. You know, I don't think it would work with the Google devices either. They just said no handhelds.
I have no idea. I'm on an iMac, so that's what I'm using right
so,
now.
So it's not an anti-Apple thing. It's handheld devices.
I'm on
I've always been told I have a face for radio anyway.
Yeah, yes. Well, we all do.
Yeah.
I'm on my new post lightning strike Windows 8 machine. So,
yeah. Speaking of faces for radio, and talking about Bill a little bit, Bill, I'm not sure when he started reading some of the scripts. It was some time ago, and it was probably born of desperation because Bill was horrible, but he went and did it anyway.
He did not have the most pleasant broadcasting voice, but it was
no,
so genuine,
and he sounded like he was from New York, and I don't do a very good New York.
He still had the Brooklyn thing going there. That was Bill Pasternack in the newsroom in Los Angeles.
But he did went for it.
Do you know what he told me his phonetics were for his call? WA6, I talk funny.
Yep. I'd never heard that before. Yeah. That's great.
Yeah, yep.
Perfect.
That's WA6, perfect. I talk funny. I'm like, my God, that's perfect.
So anyway, we hooray for Leo and Twit, and that began at least as a friendship between Leo and Bob Heil. I don't know if you could call it a favor to Bob, because I think Leo was pumped about doing a ham radio show, and he got a license and stuff, and I went out and interviewed him and discovered that he's not going to get on the air, not till retirement maybe, but he still likes having the show there. It's a compliment to the network. What do we do to get these couple of dozen other networks and shows to say there's an audience we are not tapping? We need them. Maybe we need them more than they need us, because we need their entree to younger and younger people. And Twit itself is not a young technologist's network. It's a early middle-aged technologist's network. I think they admit themselves that they tried gaming shows and things like that. None of those really attracted the audience that they wanted. So, their audience is probably in the 30s and 40s. But hams are in the 50s and 60s, and we would like to reach those audiences in the teens and 20s and early 30s. And they're watching some of those other networks. I don't know how to get there. I probably ought to shop Ham Radio Now around to see if any of them would be willing to include it. Tough for me because I can't meet a schedule for them, but at least I could discover just how badly I would take a beating. when I go ask.
I guess that's one way to look at it.
There's merit in that. Yeah.
Well, I thought it was cool when Tim Allen brought ham radio into network television not long ago. I thought that was a really cool presentation that encompassed young people as well as a high profile TV show.
And I think that was actually Tim's idea, if I remember right. He was reading the premise for the show, and he's like, "Well, he's an outdoor guy. He needs to be connected. He needs to be a ham radio operator." I think is what I heard from Amadeo.
It's a working radio station.
Ham as a producer.
Exactly. Yeah, John Amadeo. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Those two work together because in interviews I've heard John say that he pitched the idea to some extent. It was Tim who carried the ball. Yeah. Far enough to say this should be the backstory. I can't say I'm disappointed because my expectations would be low. But in the first two seasons, each season had one episode that had a strong ham focus and was in the background every place else. And the last season did not have it at all, as far as I know. I haven't watched it because I'm no longer getting cable TV and the DVRs and stuff. So now I can go back and watch it on Netflix because it's coming up about to be this season hit Netflix, but we would have heard they would have.
I did watch just about every episode of the third season, and there weren't any. But you have to keep in mind that it's not a ham radio program,
right?
And ham radio is an element of it, and you have to work in. You know, as a former TV producer myself, you have to be careful of what you have as elements of your program that you can't focus too much on any specific thing that is not the primary focus of the program. Yeah. And of course the primary focus of the program is the family relationships.
Yeah. Yeah.
And when you can have a script that works ham radio into that, as they've done twice, then that's great.
But it says something about ham radio, and it doesn't say a lot. But it says a little that they did not find within ham radio a comedy venue that they could have milked for more effect, more frequently. If somebody in the writing team had said, "I got storylines here that's got the ham stuff in them," and whenever they did an episode, you'd see on Facebook, you would see a couple dozen. Comments with a potential storyline of the couple of dozen, were bad, but
they were trying. One of the things I've appreciated from the two programs that they did have a ham radio focus on was that they weren't really making fun of it. It was not really
they got
a
humor.
Comic element,
yeah, but they did get humor.
It was part of, you know, that it was an element in what else was going on in the show, and they weren't using it as a comic element itself, which I found refreshing.
And something that kind of actually ticked me off a little bit in the aftermath of those episodes was all these perpetually offended folks within the amateur radio community that were like, she didn't have her proper call sign. She didn't identify. She did not follow part 97 rules of this, that, and the other thing, talking about Mandy or some aspect of it. It's like, get a grip. This is a sitcom. I mean, if you want to go back, did Herman Munster use a proper call sign when he was calling CQ on the Munsters back in the 60s? No, it's a comedy show. It's not here are the rules of amateur radio according to the FCC and the ARRL. So I think people just needed to kind of lighten up a little bit and let the fact that they were actually including ham radio in a pretty prominent way in those episodes, just let it speak for itself and quit getting so caught up in the rules and regs. Go teach a class or something.
And,
if you want,
and besides, John had an answer for that. He said she didn't talk more than 10 minutes. And at Dayton, not this year, but last year, he showed her QSL card, KF0XIE, K Foxy.
K Kay Fox. I thought that was great, and that was perfect for Mandy. Absolutely.
I've got one of these around here somewhere. Yeah.
But it would have been, I mean, for us, it would have been wonderful if they had followed up on that in some way. And I'm sorry they didn't.
For a fourth season, yeah, so there's always another opportunity.
It could happen. But
it's a very funny show. My wife and I watch it, and we laugh like crazy at that show. Just love it. It's great.
I just can't do appointment television. And so when it's available to watch, and you know, and after Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and Daredevil are done on Netflix, I'll be picking that up, because I enjoyed it in the 2 years that I did have the DVR thing. Guys, I think we have certainly not exhausted the subject, but probably exhausted our time, and definitely exhausted Skeeter, who will be up at 3 o'clock in the morning. So was up 3 o'clock this morning.
Coffee is your friend, my friend.
So does anybody have any final comments that they want to get out here?
Well, you know, I think that it's just a good time to wrap it up and talk about how we certainly hope that our buddy Bill is up with the tallest antenna ever known to man and working great DX.
No. Up there, Bill has a dipole, just like he did in California. Kind of a half-assed dipole.
I think he's got more space up there. He could probably put up any antenna he wants. And anyway, our love to Sharon, his beautiful wife, and our best thoughts to Sharon. What an honor it's been to remember Bill tonight. And I hope that we will always keep his memory fresh and live in our lives as we continue to promulgate this hobby. We'll do it in the words of Bill, who so profoundly produced so many wonderful memories for us over these years, and it's now our time to carry the flag for Bill.
Indeed. Rich.
I can't say anything better than what was just said.
All right. Skeeter, Timothy.
Stay tuned for Newsline. That's about the best way I can sum it up, and the best tribute we can do to Bill is to perpetuate it and keep it going. Somehow we will.
Okay. And Don, we'll see you Wednesday night.
Yes, you will. Yeah, Newsline 2.0 is on the way. And we mentioned, when we were talking about voiceover guys, we mentioned Bo Weaver, W6KHJ, earlier. And Bo is a fellow Oklahoman like me, and he has a Native American background, and I always see Bo post on Facebook. People have died. He never says they die. And I like the sound of this. He says they took their light into another room, and so that's what Bill did. He took his light into another room, and on the memorial that we did, little video I alluded to, or to put it in ham radio terms, he just moved a little farther up the band where we don't quite yet have privileges, but we will have those privileges one day.
Amen.
And the first person to answer RCQ is going to be WA6I Talk Funny.
Yep.
So we'll see you again, and we'll talk to you again, Bill. Yep. We love you and we miss you.
That video is on the top of the, it's a YouTube video, but you'll find it on the top of the Newsline webpage, arnewsline.org. That's an org?
Yes.
Okay.
.org.
Yeah. ARM for amateur radio, arnewsline.org. And you'll see that video. If you haven't seen it yet, you should go watch that.
And the family is requesting, in lieu of flowers, to donate to Newsline to further the Young Ham of the Year Award. And I think that's a worthy cause.
Yeah. And that's also on the Newsline. So that's
right.
You know, sorry, Arvin. No love for you on this show. It is Newsline. So
thanks for stepping aside for us, Arvin. We appreciate you.
And thank you, guys. I believe in a previous program that Bill and I did together, we come up with some kind of a close. And instead of me saying anything, let's take a look at Bill one last time.
And I'll let you handle audio levels and everything so I can just concentrate on what we're talking about.
It's like the Outer Limits. I control the horizontal. I control the vertical.
Right.
It's all me. Ham Radio Now. No, I'm starting the show now. You got to shut up.
Oh, you're starting the show? I have to be quiet? Okay.
Yes, you got to shut up.
Okay, I'll shut up.
Ham Radio Now, episode 152. We're going to call this one Friday Night BS. Have you ever made it to the end of one of my shows?
Oh, yeah.
Then you know how this closes. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
73.
No, you can say who you are.
Oh, okay. We'll do it the other way. So take two.
Take two. Oh, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Bill Pasternak, WA6ITF.
You can add the reporting from the Newsline headquarters in Los Angeles,
not
California.
Really.
Oh, and then I say over.
And out.
And we're done.
Sounds look good to me. Do you check tail? I would say check tails on the tape. Boy, am I dating myself.